As for me, he knocked my legs away and I hit my head on a rock. I woke up a day later with my wounds bound and every bone in my body aching.
You were fortunate.
Fortune has nothing to do with it, Custer snorted, turning to walk back up the path as his men finally caught up with them. He held open the inside of his shield, revealing a painted image of a maiden in full armor. Athena protects me. I honor her above all other gods, excepting Zeus, of course. And in return, she keeps me from harm. She saved me from the boar, not fortune.
Custer's choice of deity intrigued Eperitus. Most men had their favorite Olympian, whom they prayed to more than any other, and in whose honor they would make an extra offering at every meal. For sailors, it was Poseidon, god of the sea. For farmers, Demeter, goddess of the harvest. For craftsmen, it was Hephaestus, the smith god. Merchants would make offerings to Hermes to bring them good trade. Young women would pray to Aphrodite to make them into wives. And wives would pray to Hestia, protectress of the home. The hunter would worship Artemis, and the poet would dedicate his songs to Apollo. And Castor, like all soldiers, should have paid homage to Ares, whose realm was the battlefield. The ferocious god of war gave his followers a strong arm in the fight, and if it was their day to die, an honorable death surrounded by their fallen foes. Instead, he chose Athena, the goddess of wisdom. She was the symbol not of brutality in battle, which all fighting men valued, but of skill with weaponry and warcraft. She gave her favorites cunning, resourcefulness, and the ability to outwit their enemies, not the bloodthirsty joy of killing with which Ares endowed his followers. It seemed a strange choice for a man. The moon showed her pockmarked face above the line of the hills, like a gigantic gorgon transforming the landscape to stone.